Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So I'm grateful.
I think mic is on.
Hare Krishna. Yes. So I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you today. And I will speak on the topic of when advice works and when wise works. So I'll speak this in two parts. Today and tomorrow also, I have one more class in Abudhabi. But today's class will also be complete in its own way. And I'll speak this at 3 points. After each point, we'll have a little pause. If any of you have any questions, you can answer those questions. And then we move forward. And I'll speak this based on the relationship between Vidur and Dhritarashtra. And how that advice sometimes worked and sometimes it did not work. Why did it happen like that? So, first point I'll talk about is how there are people who are wise and there are people who are otherwise. So Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita in the 16th chapter that dva vimau purushau loke sharaschakshareva cha. So he talks about it two times. I'll complete this. That he talks about this as that there are two kinds of people, one who are liberated and one who are bound. But even among those who are bound, there are two kinds of people. There are those people who want to stay bound and go deeper into illusion, and those who want to come out of illusion. Then he talks about dvau bhuta sargau lokesmin daiva asura evacha. This he talks about the 16th chapter. The earlier was on the 15th chapter. So 15th chapter, what is given is a big category. There are bound and there are liberated. Say so we could say that there are sober people and there are alcoholic people. But among the alcoholic people, there are some who want to give up their alcoholism. They want to recover from their alcoholism. And there are some who just want to continue it. They just want to continue it and they think that I can just enjoy and I won't have any consequences. About alcoholism, it is said that first the drinker takes the drink. Then the drink takes the drink. And then the drink takes the drinker. So that's how the desire goes. First you think, I am drinking, but then the desire just keeps growing, and then the desire just consumes the person completely. So broadly, when we say that there's two kinds of people, what makes people different? Is it from the philosophical perspective, we understand that everybody is a soul. Everybody is a part of God. So at one level, we could say that if all people are souls, then everybody should be similar. It's interesting, if we look from the material perspective, nowadays there's a great ethos towards equality. You know, any kind of discrimination is bad. I was in Sydney a few months ago, and in Sydney, they had, not at that time, some day earlier, they had one of the biggest assemblies where thousands of people in Sydney assembled together. And they all had a notice, we are sorry. It was like a collective apology to the native Australians. That when we came there, we exploited you, we abused you, we discriminated against you. So they apologized. So the idea is, any kind of injustice that has happened, it should be corrected. Any kind of discrimination that has been there, it should be stopped. So people want equality, whether it is between the races or genders, or communities, there should be equal rights for everyone. But at the same time, if we look at people from a material perspective, any parameter we may take, that is IQ, EQ, physical strength, singing ability, managing ability, cooking ability, people are not equal. We have a deep intuition, deep sense that there should be equality. But if you look at the evidence around us, people are not equal from the material perspective. No parameter we will take at a material level will find that people are equal. Because heights are different, their weights are different, their complexions are different. So our very longing for equality points to some reality beyond matter. At material level, there's no reason for things to be equal. But still we feel that there should be equality. This suggests that there is something beyond matter from which that longing for equality comes. So what the Bhagavad Gita explains is that at the level of soul, we are all equal. But at the level of the body, the soul is covered by the body and the mind. And depending on the kind of covering that is there in the body and the mind, the soul behaves differently. So when we say some people are wise and some are otherwise, that is because the soul is covered differently. The body and the mind condition the soul to behave in particular ways. And I said earlier that there are some people who are bound but they want to come out of bondage. And some people are bound who want to stay in bondage, thinking that that is where pleasure is. So this difference comes because of people's conception of what will make them happy. So there is weakness and there is wickedness. So weakness is something which all of us have. Some of us have a weakness, we may get angry too much. Some of us may have weakness towards greed. Some of us may have weakness towards envy. So these are weaknesses which everyone has. But weakness, we could say, is at one extreme. It is not a very dangerous thing. But when weakness is indulged in, when weakness is not seen as a weakness, when weakness is seen as a source of pleasure, when somebody thinks, oh, I have greed, the more I indulge in my greed, then I can become powerful, I can become happy. Some people, everybody gets angry. But when some people delight in seeing how much fear they can create in others by their anger, then they move from weakness towards wickedness. So when people delight in their weaknesses, people delight in their lower desires, that is when they start becoming wicked. Krishna talks about this in the Bhagavad Gita 16.13.14.15, where he states that how everybody wants money. Artha is not the problem. Artha everybody needs. But when artha is separated from dharma, when wealth is separated from ethics, then that leads to anartha. Artha separated from dharma leads to anartha. And that's what he says. In 16.13 he says, how materialistic people scheme or earn a lot of money. Idam adhyamaya labdham imam prapse manoratham idam asti idam apime bhavishyati punardhanam. So this much money I've got with this scheme, and I'll do that, and I'll earn that much more money. And this way I'll increase my money more and more. Now, this means it's normal. Everybody wants to increase their money. That's fine. But what happens is, there, this greed, when they delight in it, then they go to any extremes. Asau maya hata shatrur hanishye cha paranapi ishvaro aham aham bhogi siddho aham balvan sukhi asau maya. People, anybody who comes in the way of their earning money, they're ready to kill them. And they not only kill, but they kill in delight. See how clever I am. See, I eliminated this enemy, and I'm going to eliminate that enemy also. So this delight in doing devilish things, that is dangerous. Asau maya hata shatru hanishye cha paranapi. And then Ishvaro aham aham bhogi. Person thinks, I am the controller, I am the enjoyer. Adyo vijanvanasmi konyasti sadrushomaya yakshe dasyami modishya itya agyana vimohitaha. Krishna says, such people are agyana vimohitaha. They are deluded by ignorance. They think that they are becoming happy, but they are only making their future hellish for themselves. So when people are wise, so I talked about weakness and wickedness. So when people are wise, they recognize weakness to be weakness and they try to minimize it. They try to decrease it. They try to control it and purify themselves of it. So everybody has anger, everybody has greed, everybody has envy. But some people try to decrease it and some people try to increase it. So the difference, Krishna says, is based not just on the conditioning that we have, but is based on our attitude towards our conditioning. If we think, oh, this is the way, becoming greedy, becoming angry is the way to happiness, the way to power, the way to control, then that is dangerous. But if you recognize this is a weakness and I want to overcome it, then there is the possibility of auspiciousness, there is the possibility of a bright future. So now, so there are, even in weakness also, we could say, I talk about three, weakness and wickedness. But we could, I talk about two things, but you could have a third thing over here. That is, that there could be people who have very few weaknesses. They have virtues and they have less vices. And there are some people who have vices, but it's mild. And some people who have great vices. So on this continuum, on the spectrum, we could say, Vidur is a person who has very little vices, is virtuous. Dhritarashtra is a person who has weakness. And Dhritarashtra is weakness. And Duryodhan is wickedness. So, virtue, vice. But there's virtue, weakness and wickedness. So, when advice works and when vice works, that's our topic. So, what we're discussing is Dhritarashtra is in between. When Duryodhana's words work on Dhritarashtra, and when Vidura's works on Dhritarashtra. We'll see this dynamism and how Dhritarashtra's life is actually determined by whose words he hears. So, based on our conditionings and more importantly on our attitude towards our conditionings, we can be either virtuous or weak or wicked. So, any questions at this point? Yes?
How
does a person come to know that they are greedy?
Yeah, because moving towards money-minded or there's no awareness or there's no alertness happening in the heart and mind that is getting greedy.
Okay. Yeah, how do we know that we become greedy? I think there are two things over here. The growth is a natural state of the human condition. Of all living beings, in fact. See, all of us, we're unicellular organisms at one time. And now, millions of cells in our body. So we have grown. So to grow and to want to grow is natural. But cancer is also growth. However, cancer is growth that is disproportionate and destructive. So one cell starts growing so much, or one set of cells, that they start damaging and destroying the remaining body. Similarly, for us to want to grow in life is natural. We want to grow in our social position, we want to grow in our relationships, we want to grow in our finances, we want to grow in our career, that's fine. But when the desire for growing in a particular way becomes so obsessive that it starts eroding and destroying other aspects of our life, when it becomes disproportionate and destructive. So, when for earning money, people start neglecting their spirituality, neglecting even their families. Yes, obsessed with work, workaholics. There are people who just ruin their relationships and their spirituality just to earn a lot of money. And then they have a huge amount of money and they have big houses. And then the big houses can only offer them the privilege of feeling unhappy and lonely in a huge space. That's tragic. So basically, we can focus on one aspect of our life, but we also need to have an overall sense of balance. So when one desire starts consuming us so much that it erodes other aspects of our life, that's when we can say that greed is happening. The greed is coming in. That's one aspect to it. Second aspect to it is that when we start becoming greedy, attachment doesn't mean just thinking about a thing. No, it is not that just because you think of money, think of a particular sense object, that doesn't necessarily lead to attachment. Attachment means not being able to stop thinking about it. So when somebody is somebody comes to a particular place, I remember one of my, when I was in newly joined as a brahmachari and I was in the Juhu temple, so one of my relatives had come to meet me, and they came to the room where I was staying, one of the guest rooms. I was visiting Juhu also. So then they came there, I took them to the temple hall and they had darshan of the deities, and then they came to the room and the first thing they said, you know, this furniture is so good. I think we should also purchase this furniture at our house. So they didn't see the Krishna at all. All that they saw was the furniture in the guest house. So what happens is that if one just keeps thinking about one thing, and even when it comes to temple, but they can't stop thinking about their own material objects. That thought might come, but when one starts speaking about that, that means it's very prominent in their minds. So to not be able to stop thinking about it, to become compulsive about it, that is where greed comes. That is where, if one is constantly thinking about money and can't stop thinking about money, and that consumes one, and people start reducing everything to monetary terms, then that's when we can say greed is dominating. Okay? Thank you. So, any other questions?
Yes. I have this question that you said you have mentioned, that at the level of soul, we are all equal.
Mm.
But then we also say that we are individual souls.
Yeah.
So how do we understand that? That's one question.
Okay.
Another question is...
One question. Let's take one.
Third question.
Okay.
That when we have vices, so we say that everything is a reflection of the spiritual world. So is it coming, because this is the question from someone else.
Okay.
Let's say that, are the vices also there in this spirit?
Okay, good question. So, are the first question was?
Sorry. Equal.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So, we are all equal, but we are also individual. How does that work out? See, equal is not identical. We are equal, say for example, we could have equality in different ways. If somebody has, say, 100 dirham, now they can buy with that 100 dirham many different items. So that cost is equal, but the objects themselves are very different. So similarly, the soul is equal in the sense that the soul is Satchitananda, the soul is a part of Krishna, the soul is loved by Krishna. But at the same time, that every soul is an individual. So equality is not equality is more in more in our nature. Equality does not mean being equal is not identical, because all of us are individual. So all of us have fundamental common characteristics. Each of us is Satchidananda, each of us is part of Krishna, each of us is loved by Krishna. In that sense we are equal. But every one of us has an individual relationship with Krishna. And so are the anarthas, are the vices present in the spiritual world? Because this world is a reflection of the spiritual world? Yes and no. What is the nature of the material world is that it is not just a reflection of the spiritual world, it is a distorted reflection or a perverted reflection of the material, of the spiritual world. So if we have a tree and it's reflected in the river. Now in the river, waves may also come. The water may move up and down. And then that tree will be shifted and it will appear distorted. So the reflection may have shapes that the original tree may not have, because there are the waves in the water that are reflecting it. So basically, we can say the desire or the power of desiring is present in the spiritual world also. Krishna has desires and we have desires. Krishna has emotions and we have emotions. So that power of desire is there in the spiritual world. But when we come to the material world, that power of desire gets distorted in different ways. So whether we consider anger, greed, envy, any kind of the desires which we consider unholy, they are basically originally what? They're desire. So desire is not bad. In fact, to be conscious is to be desirous. When we are conscious, we say, oh, this looks nice. This is not, I want this, I don't want this. So to be desirous is natural. But when the desire becomes unhealthy, when the desire becomes self-centered, when the desire, instead of being in the spiritual world, the desire is service-centered. You want to serve Krishna, please Krishna, and delight in Krishna. But when that desire becomes self-centered, that is when the problem comes up. So the anarthas are not present in the spiritual world. We could say that even they are present in the spiritual world in the pure form. But in the pure form, they are so different that to equate the two would also be inappropriate. That means that So Krishna and the gopis, they are attracted to each other. But their attraction is purely for at the spiritual level, where the gopis want to please Krishna and Krishna wants to please the gopis. Whereas here, we want other people to please us. So other people are just, largely speaking, the tools by which we will try to use them to please ourselves. So now if we consider this sattva, rajas and tamas, this is the spiritual world. And the reflections, as I said, they are distorted. So the distortion, the magnitude of the distortion will depend on whether it is sattva, rajas or tamas. In tamas, people will be extremely self-centered. So we could say that in sattva, people say, okay, let us share. We have this much, you take this, I take this. Now that sharing may also not be because of selflessness too. It may be that if I don't take that person's share, that person will not take my share. So we can have peace. We can have morality, but it is more of operational morality. So it is said that in most cases, morality is lack of opportunity. Because people don't have an opportunity to be moral, so they are moral. So in sattva, there may be ethics, but they are more operational ethics. There are no foundation for those ethics. What is the ultimate value? In rajas, yes, let us all share, but I want the best part. I want the best, you also can have, but all of you should be below me. In tamas, no, people are super eye specialists. I first, I only. So it's like that. So there is obsessive individualism. See, individuality can come from our spirituality. Our individuality can come from our spirituality, but individualism, obsessive individualism, that is rajasic and tamasic. So to the extent there is distortion, to that extent there is difference from the pure nature of the spiritual world. So the pure desires are present in the spiritual world, the impure desires, the distorted desires are present in this world. And what we call as anarthas are basically distortions of the pure desires. Okay. Thank you. So move on to the second point. First point I said is that we have virtue and vice. In vice we have weakness and wickedness. So all of us have a combination of all these. We may also have something which is wicked within us, something which is weak within us, and we have some virtues within us. In one sense, every individual is a complex composite of various kinds of qualities and deficiencies. In scripture, when certain characters are described or depicted, they are depicted with certain characteristics prominent, so that we can observe in bright color, and then that will register within us better. Now if you look at Dhritarashtra's life, he was born blind. And throughout his life, he just felt deprived because of that. He felt deprived. I was born in a royal family. And although I was born in a royal family, but still, I couldn't become the king. And then that sense of deprivation eventually projected onto his son. Say, whatever I couldn't get, my son should get. So that desire is also natural. If something we could have had and we don't get it, to feel deprived is natural. Now, for our loved ones, for our children to have what we don't have, that is also natural. But where, again, he went wrong is, he lost a sense of proportion. If we consider Vidur, at one level, Vidur was also deprived, isn't it? He was also born in the royal family, but he was born on the, as they say in English, the wrong side of the bed. That means he was born when Dhritarashtra united with a maid servant. So he was, so not Dhritarashtra. No, Vyasadev, he was, oh, I'm sorry. What I spoke about, there was a son of Dhritarashtra and Yudhisthira. That's a different thing. So when Dhritarashtra was in Gandhari's pregnancy, went for a long time. Dhritarashtra united with a maid servant, and from that Yudhisthira was born. And Yudhisthira was a half son of his, so Yudhisthira was the only person who lived. And eventually, he did the last rites for all the Kauravas, because they had all died. So anyway, the point is, Vidur, he was also a part of the royal dynasty, but because when this ritual of Niyoga was done. That time, instead of Ambika or Ambalika, they had brought a maid servant over. So he was considered to be not exactly a part of the royal dynasty. So he was also deprived. So it's, but we don't see him throughout the Mahabharata living with that sense of deprivation. That he is accepted and moved on. All of us, we have certain situations in our life that are not changeable. When I address sometimes, and I go to some places where I address people with special needs, say people who have some physical handicap or something like that. After that, when I talk with them, one thing that strikes me so many times is that they are still fighting battles that they have lost long ago. They're still fighting battles that they have lost long ago. So if somebody has lost eye, somebody has lost a limb, somebody has got some physical deficiency and there is no way to cure it, then they're still resenting it. Why this? Why this? Why this? When I look back at myself, you know, when people notice me, people hear my classes or read my books, but when they notice me and I need to use crutches, that's the first thing they notice. But for me, the crutches are like glasses. I need them, but I hardly ever think about them specifically. So when I look back, I notice that when I was growing up, my parents, they just accepted me the way I was. And they of course tried their very best to cure me. It was a quirk of fate, we could say that. We were living in a remote part of India, a little remote part, and there parents took me to a doctor when I was one to give a polio vaccination, and the doctor had made a mess of the vaccine, so the vaccine ended up giving me the polio. So my parents accepted it, and somehow because they accepted it, so I never really felt resentful about it. So we need to, when certain things are unchangeable in our life, accepting them is important. And if we don't accept them, then that lack of acceptance creates a constant sense of negativity within us. So Dhritarashtra never could accept that I can't be the king. There is, now he, when his younger brother, who was that, who became the king? Pandu. So when Pandu became the king, Pandu was very respectful always of Dhritarashtra. Pandu was also conscious that he is my senior. And whenever Pandu would win, would fight, get some tributes from other kingdoms, and come back, he would offer it to Dhritarashtra. So, as far as etiquette was concerned, Pandu followed that. And Dhritarashtra did not have complaints specifically of Pandu. But he had complaints of life itself. And so, in a sense, in a practical sense, he was not deprived of any royal comforts or even royal honors. The king honored him as a venerable senior. But still, that sense of deprivation, he could never give it up. And because he held on to that, for all of us, certain things happen in our life. When they happen, if we can accept it, then we move on. But if we don't accept it, then our mind stays stuck like in a reel that is going round and round and round and round again and again and again. Sometimes, say, if a sports match is going on, and say some batsman hits a brilliant sixer, or some bowler bowls very well and clean bowls, so people do action replay. We'll see it again. Now, our mind keeps doing the action replay. But often the mind does action replay, not just of pleasant things, but also of unpleasant things. Why did this happen? Krishna says that such is the characteristic of the mind in tamas. Ya swapnam bhayam shokam vishadam madameva cha navimunchati durmedha ritisaparta tamasi. He says that when we hold on to thought patterns that hurt us, fearfulness, swapnam, daydreaming, swapnam, bhayam, shokam, lamentation. Why did this happen? Vishadam. Vishadam is moroseness. Life always treats me badly. My destiny is only broken. So when we start habitually thinking like that, then that is tamasic. So Dhritarashtra, somehow he never was able to accept this, that okay, this is my limitation. And when he did not accept it, his hope became that if I have a son, he will become the king. And then that led to irrational attachment. Attachment is natural. For a parent to have attachment to the children is natural. But because it was not just a normal parental attachment to a child, it was all his resentment, his sense of deprivation projected onto the son. So what happened? He thought life did not fulfill my desire to be a king. Therefore, my son is my extension. So I will fulfill every desire of my son. And thus he started pandering to his son excessively. So when we, how our mind will work when distresses come in our life, how our mind processes them, and how we respond to them will shape whether that distress will make us bitter or whether it will make us better. Distresses, injustices, they happen in everyone's life. Now Vidur, he accepted that I am not going to be the king. And he focused on cultivating knowledge. He would sit with Brahmins, he would discuss with them, he would learn from sages. And he recognized, okay, I can't be the king. It's fine. If I am in this royal family, let me see how best I can serve in this situation. He thought, I cannot be the king, I can be an advisor to the king. And he learned knowledge so well that he could become an expert advisor. In fact, there's a whole compilation which is called as Viduraniti. It says we have Chanakyaniti, so we have Viduraniti. So he accepted a situation and found a way ahead in that situation. When life closes one door in front of us, sometimes we can either choose, just keep glaring at that door, hoping that by our glare the door will burn down and we'll move it. Or, you know, okay, this door is closed, let me see if some other door is open in my life. Can all of you please come a little ahead? Yeah. So, Vidur found a door that was open and moved forward and grew in wisdom. Dhritarashtra kept resenting the door that was closed and he kept feeling deprived. So for all of us, when life treats us, when life gives us something very unfair, something very bad, at that time it's up to us whether we keep resenting it or we redirect our energy towards somewhere else. So if we keep fighting battles that we have already lost, then we become lost. But we accept that this battle is lost, let me find out which battle I can fight. Let me find out which battle I can win. Then we can move forwards. Dhritarashtra kept fighting the battle that was lost and eventually he ended up lost. So any questions to this point? Yes.
As for the dynasty, Dhritarashtra was being electric in the kingdom to Pandu because of his pipeline. The dynasty dharma, when Pandu was being left, but by the dharma just being handover to the dynastic dharma to Duryodhana because he's the first son.
Okay. Good question. It's a complex subject. I'll try to answer as briefly as I can. So, wasn't it that, say, by Kula Dharma, if Dhritarashtra could not become the king, Pandu became. But after Pandu, shouldn't it be that Dhritarashtra's son, Duryodhana being the eldest, should become the king? Two things here. First of all, that Dhritarashtra was not the oldest. What happened was that Gandhari became pregnant, but her pregnancy went on for a very long time. And then Pandu had retired to the forest, and Pandu couldn't unite with his wives. So then he also used Niyoga, and then he of course had the gods impregnate Kunti and Madri, and Yudhishthir was the first son who was born. And when Yudhishthir was born, at that time, when the news reached Gandhari, she was upset. She was furious. She got so angry that she bet her embryo. She said, why is this not coming out? And then she had a kind of miscarriage. When Vyasadeva came, because she had been very faithfully adhering to dharma, serving her husband, serving the sages, Vyasadeva had blessed her. And she said, I had this miscarriage. Vyasadeva said, I have blessed you. So from this lump of flesh that has come out, you keep it in a particular way, chant some mantras, and I'll chant some mantras, I'll don't take power, and from there, you will have 100 sons. So the first son was born after Yudhishthira was born. So now, when the Pandavas were living in the forest, nobody knew whether they would actually come back to the kingdom or not. So the Duryodhana itself was likely to become the king. And Duryodhana was treated like the heir apparent, as they say, the bosom of the next king. So he developed an entitlement mentality. All this is mine. And then, when Pandu passed away, unfortunately, then the Pandavas came back. The sages told that you should come back to the kingdom. They told Kunti. So then, and now the Pandavas, they were by nature virtuous, and by upbringing, they had lived with the sages in the forest. And because they were austere, because the forest life is not a comfortable life, so they were not pampered. So they were not pampered, and they were very cultured and respectful. So when they came to the kingdom, at that time, just because they were new, everybody started paying more attention to them. And because they were so cultured, right, these people, the citizens and the courtiers, all of them started getting attracted toward the Pandavas. And then that made Duryodhana feel, hey, what is this? I was the center of attention, and why is all this attention going to them? So he started becoming very envious of them. The Pandavas never claimed that we should have all the kingdom. So we could say that at that point when Dhritarashtra and Pandu things got confused, the Pandavas never demanded the full kingdom, ever. So even when Krishna came as a peace messenger, they were asking only for Indraprastha, which they themselves had built from, you could say, the wilderness. And Duryodhana refused even that to them. So we cannot say that Duryodhana had an undisputed right to the whole kingdom. Because he was, his father, although he was on the throne, but Dhritarashtra, because Pandu had gone away, Duryodhana was on the throne, but Pandu never, Dhritarashtra was never officially the king. He was more of a caretaker king. So there was no right necessarily that his son would naturally become the king. So because Pandu had been the king, you could say at one level Pandu's son could become the king. So it was confused, but at the very least you could say that kingdom could have been divided equitably. But Duryodhana was not ready even for that. And that's why the war happened. Okay? Thank
you. Maybe one more question.
Yeah.
You were telling about the distresses when it comes and the negativity increases. And the negativity increases, the resentment also increases. So, and when distresses comes in multi-folds and within a short period of time, how to come out of this negativity and resentment?
Yeah.
So it's really challenging and you're not able to come out of that mind.
So when multiple distresses come and we're not able to come out of negativity and resentment, what to do? Yeah, I was in America at the time of Thanksgiving, so I was asked to speak at various places on that topic. Spoke in some prominent banks also. So basically, we cannot be grateful for all situations. Bad things do happen in life. But even though we can't be grateful for all situations, we can be grateful in all situations. What is the difference? That this bad thing has happened to me. But even when this bad thing has happened, there are good things in my life. So I gave a talk on the topic of ace your life with gratitude. Ace is acronym, A-C-E. A is around. Around means, this bad thing has happened, look for the good around the bad. Yes, bad things are there in my life, I can't deny that. And some other thing, oh, this is good. No, it's not good. Okay, but there are, this bad thing, suppose somebody suddenly loses their job. That's a bad thing. But then, okay, we can look at what are the good things. I have experience, I have some training, I have contacts, I can find something. So, we can look at the good that is there. Suppose somebody got a disease suddenly. That's a bad thing. But then, okay, this is curable. Maybe I've got a good health system. I've got some supportive family. I've got some trustworthy doctor friends. Whatever. Look for the good around the bad. That's A. And C is a little more specific. Look for the good that helps us to combat the bad, to counter the bad. So, A could be just generally, there's so many good things in my life. But C is, what are the good things that help me to counter the bad? When just the bad thing has happened, we feel powerless. But when you see, okay, these are the resources I have by which I can deal with it, then we feel a little more empowered. And E is emerge. Emerge means look for the good that may emerge from the bad. Life goes in cycles. And when, if we consider a wave, when the wave goes down, the more the wave goes down, the more it will rise up. So many times, life is also like that. Bad things happen, and from those bad things, some good emerges. If we look back at our own lives also, some things might have seemed terrible when they happened. But now we may look back and say, okay, actually this was some good emerged from it. So everything that happens is not good. Bad things happen. But everything that happens can be for good. I mean, some good can emerge from it. And this we can have the faith also by understanding that Krishna is in control. That Krishna can bring good even out of the bad. And that is the power of Krishna. So we see the Pandavas, every time something bad happened to them, the Pandavas were living in the palace and they were sent to Varanavar to be burned alive. But from there, they escaped and eventually they got the hand of Draupadi in Swayambar. And that means that those Pandavas were just gone as practically orphans. Now they were allied with one of the most powerful kings of their times. They came back victorious. So Krishna arranged them to things to become better. Before that, when Bhima was poisoned, that was bad. But things worked out in such a way that Bhima went to Nagaloka, to Varuna the board and to with the Nagas, and there he was given nectar, which not only countered the poison, which not only was the poison countered eventually, but also he got greater strength by that. So good can emerge from the bad also. So if you look for the good around the bad, the good to counter the bad, and the good that may emerge from the bad, then we can overcome the resentment. Okay? Thank you.
Okay, so we see that sometimes as a devotee, we are expected not to be disturbed by the difficulties that occur. And we see sometimes when they're in this order, even though they are not taken up some emotional process, they're able to very well handle the situations, whereas sometimes the devotee sometimes becomes, you know, overwhelmed by the difficulties. Is it that the subtle body is like basically some people may have a weak mind or something? Is it carried over from the
So, sometimes as devotees we are expected not to get disturbed by difficulties, but people who are not devotees, they seem less disturbed and devotees get disturbed. So why is that? Yeah, I would say that each of us has a particular kind of body and a particular kind of mind. And I gave a series of classes in Australia on emotionally healthy spirituality. Our spiritual practice should be emotionally healthy. What does that mean? That means that, say, some people, they have a body that they feel very cold. Some, as soon as AC turns on, they just can't bear it. And some people, even in the cold, they can go out and nothing happens to them. If somebody starts feeling cold, and we tell them, don't feel cold. What do you mean, don't feel cold? That's not a matter of choice. I'm feeling cold. So now, what somebody can do is, although they feel cold, they may still persevere. They may wear warm clothes and they may take precautions and they will persevere. So feeling cold is not a matter of choice. It's just a matter of the kind of body we have. So just as the body, physical body is one level of reality, the mind is also one level of reality. And some minds tend to be a little more unstable, more excitable, you could say. And some minds are a little more stolid. They don't get so excited, so agitated. Now this could be because of various factors. It could be there's more sattva in some people. It could just be that that's the way the mind is. Even if you look at the Pandavas, among the Pandavas themselves, they're all devotees, but Yudhishthir, whenever there's a conflict, try to avoid the conflict. It's almost like avoid conflicts at all costs. Bhima is look for confrontation at every opportunity. When can I fight? He's itching for a fight practically. Now both of them, they have to rein in and act according to dharma. Now there is a time when Yudhishthir recognizes that I cannot just keep taking the low position. I have to stand up. That's why he decides to fight. And there are times when Bhima has an urge to fight and he has to control himself. So we cannot wish away the kind of psychophysical nature that we have. But what we can do is, we can work with our nature for Krishna. So, the way I put it is, as mentioned in the introduction, I write articles on the Gita every day at geetadaily.com. So, one article I wrote recently is that don't work for the body, don't work against the body, work with the body. This is the body that I have, and what applies to the body also applies to the mind. So if certain people are more excitable, then that is what they have to take into account, and then they have to engage in a service which is more steady, more predictable. You see, some people, they feel a sense of security and strength when there is stability, predictability, order. Some people, they need a sense of adventure and excitement. That's when they feel they are doing something. So some people say, for example, in bhakti, some people may, those who want adventure, excitement, they may want to preach, they want to meet new people, they may want to do new things for Krishna. And preaching, book distribution, organizing big, big programs, that is the kind of service that they will delight in. But somebody who likes more structure, order, predictability, they will flourish when they do services which have this. Say, for example, deity worship. Big worship, come at this time, come at this time, come at this time. And the more they work within their structure, the more they feel, yes, they are happy. Now, for somebody who likes adventure, you put them in structure. That will be torture for them. Everybody has to be engaged according to their nature. So if some people feel disturbed by life's ups and downs, then that should not be seen necessarily as a deficiency in their spirituality. It is seen just that, all of us have certain limitations, and we all have to work with our limitations.
In addition to the grief of the situation, again we feel that, oh, I'm a devotee, I'm being disturbed.
Oh,
so this is
a
feeling of guilt that comes.
Yeah, actually that is very bad. If on top of grief, guilt comes up, you know why? So the mind is so cunning that we decide, like some people say, I'm not going to become angry anymore. And then they start getting angry. And then somebody tells them, now you're getting angry. I'm not angry. So what happens? First, we become angry, and then we become angry about I become angry. And so like that, the mind can just trap us. So if we don't accept ourselves, or if the social circle around us doesn't accept ourselves, this grief is natural. If some loss is there, actually there is a difference between grieving and lamenting. Grief is in sattva-guna. Lamentation is in tamo-guna. What is the difference? This is, of course, I would say a whole class in itself. But I'd say briefly make two main points. That there is, whenever any loss is there in our life, there is a natural process of healing that is there. Suppose somebody's hand gets fractured. Then, if the hand is fractured, initially they have to rest the hand. They have to put it in a sling and keep it motionless so that it will recover. But if for the rest of their life they keep their hand motionless, then that will be unwanted. So after some time they will take the hand out of the sling and start exercising it. Exercising will be painful initially, but they have to start it. So when people are lamenting, whenever we have a loss in our life, at that time there is a pain. It's a real pain, like a fracture. So there is grief, which is a natural part of the healing cycle. In fact, in the Mahabharata also, Mahabharata as well as the Bhagavatam is described that after the Kurukshetra war got over, the Pandavas grieved the loss of their loved ones. When Dashrath Maharaj departed from the world, the Ayodhya Vasis, Bharat announced a nationwide period of mourning at that time. So grieving is essential for healing. It's like after you lost someone, we will feel bad about it. And that's natural. It's just human. To spiritualize ourselves doesn't mean to dehumanize ourselves. Human emotions are natural, but we don't stick only to the human emotions. We acknowledge the human emotions, but we also acknowledge something higher purpose to our life. So grieving is when we rest the hand on its fracture. But lamenting is that we never lift up the hand. Like some people just keep, something has happened 10 years ago and still they are going on with the same old thing again and again. So if some people may need more time for grieving, some people may need less time for grieving. Different people grieve in different ways also. So whatever is needed for a person to deal with the situation, they need to be given the space for that. Does that answer your question?
Before coming to this core, with acting with the material world, we were so diplomatic and never come to a personality and just take care.
Diplomatic and never?
We are taking more care because to be diplomatic, not to put in the problem, and we make a mistake like that in the material activity. But after coming to ISKCON, we are associated with the sober persons and sadhu, and we are trying to develop the quality of this. But what happening, every day we are activity with the material, this one, and because of our quality or something not developed on this one, we are not becoming the diplomatic with the handle with the material activity. And we are always clapping into the problem and blaming it. And every day now we are afraid of this one to trap in that problem to save us from that criteria.
Okay.
So why it is happening? We cannot go into the material diplomacy because of from our heart.
Okay, answering the question.
Yeah.
So in the past, before practicing bhakti, we used to be diplomatic, but now after practicing bhakti, because we associate with saintly people, we want to be very simple hearted. But then we still have to work with materialistic people, and that simple heartedness over there doesn't work. So we get into trouble because of that. So what to do? See, bhakti is not so much about what we do as how we do it or why we do it. There is in the Bhagavatam, there is a conversation that Vasudev tells Nanda Maharaj that you should go back to the kingdom, go back to Vrindavan. I think there is some danger over there. Go back so that if any danger comes, you will be there with Krishna. And then when he goes back, at that time Putana has attacked and Krishna has somehow survived. So there Prabhupada writes that Vasudev, being a king, was a diplomat. But Nanda Maharaj, although he was in one sense the king of the Vaishyas, but he was not a diplomat. He was simple hearted. Now both Vasudev and Nanda Maharaj are pure devotees. But both, they were acting according to their nature. Vasudev was pure hearted, but still he was shrewd. He was, to survive in the political world, he had to survive in a place where Kamsa was out to kill him. He had to be intelligent. So now generally, we shouldn't stereotype what bhakti is. The essence of bhakti is that we serve Krishna. Now how exactly we serve Krishna? Depending on the particular situation, we do what is required for serving Krishna. So we don't want to be political or cunning in terms of manipulating others. But if for our service to Krishna, anywhere our job, our career, if our life is devoted to Krishna, then what is maintained, helping us maintain our life is also a service to Krishna. So we need to do what it takes to protect that. So we shouldn't reduce bhakti to this is how a devotee has to be. Rather, a devotee means a devotee does whatever is required for the service of Krishna. And if we are living in the material world, in today's materialistic culture, then we have to practice bhakti in that materialistic culture. And whatever is required, we need to do that. So Prabhupada would often use the word, do the needful. Do the needful means that we have to see what it takes to move forward in this particular situation. And as far as being simple-hearted or diplomatic, the essence of bhakti is, of course, ultimately, we want to be simply devoted to Krishna. But we want to serve Krishna in this world. And serving Krishna in this world means that we have to recognize the ways of the world and we have to make sure that we find a way to Krishna through that. So just to do whatever is required and don't reduce bhakti to a particular stereotype. Arjuna had to fight a war and he was a devotee. But that was what was required for his service. So bhakti is dynamic. And whatever will take us to Krishna, we do that and that is bhakti. Okay. Yes. So
coming to the question which Mataji was asking, okay, and thank you for a super excellent answer. Like as you said, that the body and the mind, everyone's is different actually. But two things, when devotees sufficiently spend his time in the process, in the movement, and obviously our movement, the whole dynamic is to control the mind. That if your body is weak, you cover your body and you cover from the heat and cold. Similarly, you are covering your mind by engaging your mind in Krishna's service, by chanting the holy name, by reading Bhagavatam and all these things. So when this grief and resentment and depression and all this thing come, so there are two things. One is that if he has spent his time in the womb, he himself feels that why the process is not working for me, or maybe he might have a doubt that really does it work, or in theory only, Second, other person who looks at him as a senior devotee, they get also depressed, saying that, we are talking about, Krishna consciousness works, and here, somehow or other, this is not happening on a practical or grassroots level. So how do you really understand this point and, then from both angles you implement?
So we say Krishna consciousness essentially means to control the mind. But we find that even for somebody who has practiced bhakti for many years, the mind may go through into negative emotions, to depression, and the practitioner may feel that the process is not working. And those who are new people may also feel that, oh, this process is not working, why should I practice it? So how do we understand this? It's in the mind, because it is between the body and the soul, it is not as physical as the body, but it is also not spiritual like the soul. So the mind, you could say, falls in the gray zone. I was talking with one very senior disciple of Srila Prabhupada, who's also a spiritual master. So I asked him that as we grow older, as we practice bhakti for many, many years, do we overcome our conditioning? He said, no. As we grow older, we get tired of fighting against our conditions. And he says, we get tired of fighting against our conditioning and we start working with our conditioning for Krishna. So now the word conditioning can have many different meanings. Now if it is lust, anger, greed, these should decrease. Especially if these are taking us beyond the limits of dharma, that should decrease. And even a little practice of bhakti, by that we see this just decreases. But if we talk about conditioning in terms of nature, say some people are introvert. They just, if you give them a choice between talking with a person and being alone, they prefer to be alone. Some people are extrovert. You put them alone, they'll search for someone to talk with. So now, this is not going to change. And this doesn't need to change. So there are... sometimes we... Again, a big problem comes because we all have stereotypes of what it means to be a devotee. This is how a devotee should be. And somebody is not like this, they're not a devotee. But it's not like that. Each one of us is an individual and each one of us practice bhakti in an individual way. So if somebody goes through disappointment, depression, at that time it could also be a normal human emotion. It could be a emotion that even a devotee wanted to do something for Krishna, it didn't work out, or something terrible happened in their life, then the devotee is disheartened by that. So at that time, whatever happens, there should be other devotees who help that person to overcome that. If we see that in the Bhagavad Gita, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna instructs Arjuna that two verses we could say directly, Dhira Saptra Namuhiyati, that when the death happens, old age is death, happens, a wise person doesn't get sorrow, doesn't get disturbed. And Krishna also says that don't be attached to Putra Dara Graha Adishu, with your children, with your family, spouse, all that. But then during the Kurukshetra war, Abhimanyu is killed. And Arjuna is devastated. When Arjuna is devastated, he's first so pained, then he's so angry. He lashes out his brothers, saying that, are all your weapons just ornaments, these bangles? You couldn't protect my son? Then he even turns to Krishna. He says, Krishna, you must have known what is happening. Why didn't you tell me? So, can we be angry at God? Actually, that's again a big philosophical question. But the point is, God is big enough to even absorb our anger. So Krishna doesn't tell Arjuna at that time, hey, you forgot my Bhagavad Gita? Dhiras tatra na muhiyati. What did Krishna do? Krishna actually helped Arjuna deal with the situation. Krishna did not give any philosophy at that point. Krishna said, Arjuna, see, your brothers are as distressed as you are. Please don't speak words, you'll increase their distress. So, he helped Arjuna in a very empathic way. He did not say, all of you are in illusion. Your distress is illusion, their distress is also illusion. He helped him in a very emotionally sensitive way to rise to the situation. So there is a time to tell philosophy, and there's a time to not tell philosophy. So I would say that it is rather than having that stereotype, this is how a devotee should be. You see that whatever situation we are in, how can we be a devotee? How can I try to practice bhakti in this situation? And how can others help a person to practice bhakti in that situation? So if somebody feels disheartened by something, then there has to be some way within that disheartenment, acknowledge it. Yes, this is bad. Feel disheartened. Somebody understands them and then helps them rise. We shouldn't be made to feel guilty for our emotions. See, our emotions are often like the weather. They'll just come and they'll be there for some time. So what we can do is that rather than worrying about how we feel, we can focus on working how we act, working on how we act. Stop worrying about how you feel. Stop trying to control your emotions. Start taking control of your actions. That doesn't mean you neglect the emotions. We don't suppress the emotions, but you don't get carried away by the emotions. I'm feeling cold. I'm feeling cold, but I want to wake up in the morning for the morning. So I'll acknowledge that it's cold. I won't say it's not cold. It is cold. Similarly, I'm feeling grief. Even in the grief, I'll practice bhakti. Okay? So it's like devotion is at a particular level. Emotions are at a particular level. So the emotions will go up and down. And we acknowledge the emotions are going up and down. But we acknowledge the emotions and we persevere in our devotion. Okay. Any other questions? There's one question. Yeah.
When devotees said that they should be soft hearted, then anything happened to other devotees or other families, then we should be very soft hearted and we should pray for the Krishna. But if anything comes, so we pray like one time for one. But when it, something is happening to friends with our family, we think 100 times, 1000 and feel like it is all that it happened. But it should be otherwise. Like, if anything happened to others, so we should be more grateful. And when it is happening to us, then we should be tolerant enough that we should not think happening. But it is happening otherwise.
Okay. You know, when some bad things happen to others, we should pray for them and we should want to help them. And when bad things happen to us, we should tolerate it. But rather, you know, we get much more worked up when bad things happen to us than when something happens to others. Yes. Again, this whole idea of should doesn't work. We can say how I should act, but we cannot say how I should feel. Certain feelings will come. Now we can decide whether I dwell on them and then make the feelings grow, or I just acknowledge the feeling and move on. So with respect to practicing bhakti, you know, when bad things happen, when it happens to us, it matters to us much more. So naturally we'll be more concerned. When it happens to someone else, we cannot be so emotionally invested in everything that happens to everyone. It is said that if one person dies, it's a tragedy. If 1,000 people die, it is a statistic. So what happens is, there is a, in psychology they call it a collapse of compassion. We have a certain capacity for compassion, but when we hear so much distress, then we become desensitized to it. Just so that's again, because our emotional capacity is also limited. So it's natural that we will feel more concerned when more disturbed, when something bad is happening to us than when something is happening to others. Ultimately, we have to serve Krishna. We could see this as selfish, I'm self-centered. But we can also see that in another way, that ultimately, I am my only resource for serving Krishna. I am my only resource for serving Krishna. Nobody else can serve Krishna on my behalf. So I have to take care of myself. So a part of bhakti is learning to be kind to ourselves also. So being kind to ourselves means, yes, this is how I am, this is how I am feeling. I acknowledge that. And we move forward in that situation. So we could say that if we had a particular resource for serving Krishna and somebody else has a particular resource for serving Krishna, then we will take care of our resource first. And then we'll take care of others' resource also. So we don't have to think of ourselves, our body and mind in a possessive sense. It is my body and mind I am concerned. We can also have it in the mood of service. This is the resource I have for serving Krishna. So let me take care of this as nicely as I can. So, one article I wrote in Vidal is that we have to forgive ourselves to give ourselves to Krishna. We want to offer ourselves to Krishna. But if we are beating ourselves, why did I do that? Why did I do that? Why did I do that? But my emotion is caught in beating myself. So, what can we offer to Krishna? So, okay, I made some mistake. I was not the way I was, but I accept myself. Forgive not in the sense that I'm going to stay as I am. Forgiveness is, I accept this happened and I move on my life. With respect to helping others, we do want to help according to our capacity. And we do want to increase our capacity also. But at the same time, we have to have a sense of balance that what is the most effective way in which I can serve Krishna. If I don't care for myself at all, and then I try to serve Krishna so much, I serve others also so much, then it may well happen that we may collapse. Now we may collapse and we will not be able to help others. If somebody doesn't know swimming and they try to go and help somebody who is drowning, what will happen is that somebody will have to go and help them. They will not be of much help, they will need help. So it is also important to recognize our limitations. And Just I think if we learn to be kind to ourselves and kind to others, we'll be able to find out how best we can function. Okay? Thank you. So I was going to speak one more point, but I think I'll stop here. Are there any other questions? Maybe one last question. I'll be continuing this tomorrow. Tomorrow, where is the class?
Tomorrow it is
okay, then. So, I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke on this topic of when people listen to advice and when people listen to wise. Two main points, that some people are wise and some are otherwise. So that's, you could have some people who are conditioned and their conditions are very less. Some people are conditioned, but their conditions are the level of weakness. And some people are conditioned and they want to increase their condition, that's wickedness. So Vidura, Dhritarashtra and Duryodhana, we look at this in the continuum. And we discuss how Dhritarashtra's fate was decided by whether he would listen to the Vidura or to Dhritarashtra. And then I talked about Dhritarashtra, where when he couldn't accept that he was born blind and he couldn't become the king. So throughout his life he was fighting battles that he had already lost. Vidur also couldn't become the king, but he accepted that, and within that situation he found a way to grow. He grew more in Brahminical qualities and became an advisor, expert advisor for the king. So for us, instead of banging our head against closed doors, we can find out a door that is open and move on in our life. And then we talk elaborately about the question answer about emotionally healthy spirituality, that just as the body has its particular strengths and weaknesses, so does the mind. And just as we work with our body, we don't work for or against our body. Similarly, we work with our mind, not for or against our mind. Spiritualizing ourselves is not dehumanizing ourselves. It means that we acknowledge human emotions, but we also pursue a spiritual purpose that takes us beyond those emotions. Not beyond in the sense of neglecting, but persevering through them. Emotions are like the weather, they may come and go. Rather than trying to control the emotions, worrying about controlling the emotions, we can focus on making sure that we do the right actions. And we need a supportive system, supportive community where we can, if we are weak, then others help us rise and others help us grow. And when we practice bhakti in an emotionally healthy way, then we don't feel choked or suppressed, but rather we march ahead in our bhakti. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Shri Prabhupada ki
Jai.
Gaur Bhaktavinda ki
Jai.
Gaur Premanande.
Jai.
His Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki
Jai.